Praise the Lord, Sister Linda.
Praise the Lord, Linda.
Well, we say good morning and praise the Lord to those of you who have already joined with us and those of you that will be coming on and those of you that will view later. We are certainly grateful to the Lord this morning again for the privilege of being allowed to come to you in the presence of the Holy Ghost. For we realize that it is no goodness of ours, nothing we've done, but we are truly found in those great mercies of the Lord Jesus Christ. We do honor him, for he is our keeper, he is our deliverer, our healer, our sustainer. You know, we can just go on and on and on, because we declare we can do nothing without him. And we bless him for his goodness and for his mercy. And certainly we are just blessed to be a part of his work. For we realize that we've done nothing. We're certainly not worthy of him. But it is because of his grace and mercy that he gives us this privilege. We certainly honor the man of God sitting here with us, to our pastor, to Pastor Rogers. We bless God for him as always. We just praise God for what he continues to do in the midst of us, because we both declare the same thing. We can't do it without
him. That's right. Amen.
And we certainly honor our elect lady, to Sister Loretta. We praise God for her and for my wife, Sister Crystal, and for our Sunday school superintendent, Dr. Brayboy, and to Deacon Brayboy, and to all of those of you who are gathered in our presence and those of you who are online. I guess I sound like an echo, but it is indeed another great lesson that God has prepared for us, and we want to ready our minds and our hearts. You know, we want to give ear to what God is saying to us, because just hearing the word of God is not enough. James says in the first chapter that We must become doers of that we hear. And when we hear truth of God, then we need to move to doing it. Again, because we realize that the Word of God questions us. How does he know we love him?
Mm-hmm.
And simply says, when we do what he says. So we want to be obedient to the Lord. We certainly want to do all the things that he has given us to do. And we want to look to him. So this morning, our lesson is the burden of Nehemiah. The burden of Nehemiah. As always, we will give back. Let Pastor recognize those of you who are with us. And then he will open our lesson for us.
Again, we thank God for the privilege and the opportunity and voice the sentiment of our teacher, giving honor to all the ones who honor is due. And again, for another great lesson that God has blessed us to be a part of. And we just ask your prayers that the Lord will bless us as we go into the lesson to extract what's in the lesson, that we as his people will see what God has in store for us. And if you've been following the lesson that his teacher normally breaks it down, and I believe he will again, if you follow the different lesson, you can see God's plan unfolding. And you can see God in control of everything. Even from the very beginning, even during the gap of years, how God is orchestrating everything for his purpose and his plan, and how he just uses us to help carry out those plans. So I want your prayers for us this morning, that we, as his teachers, will bring out God's plan even in our lives and help us see how God is working with us now in the things that he would have us do. And then even when hardship come up, we won't be dismayed. We will understand it's still God working. Yeah, that we just trust him, because why? He is in control. As we have lesson 10 for November 8th, 2020, the burden of Nehemiah. With our focused thought, God places burdens on our hearts. Our focus verse is Nehemiah 2 and 18. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. Well, our lesson text coming from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 5, and also verses 17, or 1 through 5, and verses 17 through 18. And it read with these words, and it came to pass in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, the king that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is that countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad, when the city, the place of my father's sepulchre, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, What dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said unto the king, if it please the king, and if thy servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchre, that I may build it. Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burnt with fire. Come, let us build up the walls of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. The word of God for the people of God. Let us pray.
Bless your name.
Father, it is in thy precious name, Lord Jesus Christ, that we come now before you, O God, as always and before, to thank you for your blessings, to thank you for your favor, and to thank you for your anointing. Now, Father God, bless us as we said now. Reveal unto us that which you will have us reveal unto your people, that we will give them clarity and give them understanding, O God, of your purpose in our lives, that which you would have us to do. And God, as being your servants, as we will run into difficult times as we carry out your will, Lord, But bless us that we stand fast and stand true, knowing that you, oh God, hold us in your hand. You are in the controller, and you are the controller, and we have nothing to worry about. Bless us, oh God, use us for your purpose. Use us for your honor and for your glory. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And at this time, we will give you our outline, and our teacher will carry us through the lesson. Nehemiah burden at the news of Jerusalem. People in great affliction and walls broken down. Nehemiah prayed. We must allow our burdens to drive us to prayer. Nehemiah acted on his burden. He asked the king of permission to help Jerusalem. They strengthened their hands for the good work. We must allow our burdens to drive us to action.
So we're grateful, as always, to Pastor for setting our text and our outline of the lesson today. And we're just grateful for how God is continuing to speak to us by the lessons that are outlined for us to study. We like to say that our subject, what we receive as our subject, is the beginning of our study, which is the purpose and plan of God. And really, we need to stick with this so we understand the different aspects of the lesson that we are then given week by week to study. And Pastor said, we do this weekly, but we're going to try to do it quickly today because actually, the more aspects of the lesson we get, the more we can talk about it, and it can exhaust the time that we have set to study. But just as a reminder of the things that we have studied coming to this point. So it is the purpose and plan of God, and we will again see in our lesson today the burden of Nehemiah that it is not always that we're going to understand or even see, but we have to remind ourselves of this. If God has said it, then we should say amen, and then we should move forward. So we had the first lesson, a made-up heart. And those of us who know the Lord Jesus Christ know that without a heart made up, it is difficult for us to follow through. This lesson was about the young men who, after being taken into captivity into Babylon, stood for what they knew was right. That's what we must continue to do. And we have to recognize that God is in control. And just like the very first lesson we had, that things may not necessarily unfold the way we expect them. Mm-hmm. If our hearts are made up and we know that God's in control, they were convinced that they would stand for righteousness and they would not bow or serve another king. Because in the midst of it, if we stand for what's right, what's true, then the word of God came and said, God is even able to change those hearts around us who may not be where we are. But, you know, we have to be those epistles read of men. But we have to be the epistles read of men according to the word of God. When we say one thing and we do something else, then it will not allow them to seek God for a changed heart. But if you don't change your heart, the word of God says the handwriting is on the wall. You know, what will come to us, I mean, it's for all of us, because it is declared in God's word what will come to those of us who don't accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and not in the manner that we want to do it, but as the word of God says. And we have to remind ourselves that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, Paul said it, that he was the chiefest of sinners. And I say every week, Paul has a contest with me. You understand? Because I know where I came from. I know Paul was speaking for himself. Each one of us have to declare, our need for the Lord Jesus Christ and his righteousness. So maybe in Paul's mind, he was the chiefest. In my mind, I'm the chiefest. And, you know, you have to speak for yourself. But the good thing about it is it doesn't matter whether we all feel like we were the chiefest. There was a ransom paid for our being sinners, where Jesus Christ redeemed us from being the chief of what we were. And he has brought us into his righteousness and in peace with God the Father. And then we came to that knowledge that the Word of God is good for us. And that's what we need. We have to hear God's Word. And if we hear God's Word and do what God says, then we will reap the benefits of what God has said. And as always, we say if the Word of God is good for us, we shouldn't hold it because it's good for all. So we should share the Word of God with those, because, you know, there's so many people who don't know the Word of God. There's so many people who have the Word of God given to them wrongly. And I mean, we're not coming to tear down anybody. All we want to do is share out of the love of God's Word and let God draw them. Because that's what it's all about. But we should remain stirred, stirred to do the work of God. Our last week lesson says that the Lord stirred the heart of Ezra and those around him that they might go back to Jerusalem and begin to build the foundation. And Paul said to Timothy, you know, like it's a reminder. We have to keep staring the gift that God has placed in us. Listen, we're in humanity. That's not an excuse. But if we don't do that, we'll become comfortable doing what we do. And what do? Typically nothing. So then we have to continue to remind ourselves what the Word of God has called us to do. And every last one of us, every last one of us have a ministry in the work of God. And we say, if you don't know what your ministry is, you need to pray and ask God. You know, sometimes we cause total chaos by working out of our ministry, not doing what God has called us to do, but doing what somebody else should be doing or what looks good to us. No, if we work together, and we'll see that in this week's lesson. Now, the burden of Nehemiah today is our lesson. And what is a burden? A burden is something that you carry, or something, you know, that God places on your heart. It is a load that you need to unload by doing what it is that God has given you to do, and that is in your ministry. When you do that, we'll find, not necessarily without obstacle, but even through the obstacles, God will make a way for us.
And again, as teacher was breaking down the lesson to us, you know, and he said at one point, we are epistles read of men. In other words, no matter our condition or our circumstances, we should let God's light always shine in us and through us. And one of our purposes is that we should not let our situation nor our circumstances get the best of us. We should not let them control us to the place where it takes us away from God. One of the things is God allow situations to come up in our life for his purpose and for his glory. Sometimes it takes us out of our comfort zone to where we are so comfortable, to someplace else. And it's all for God's purpose. And if we understand, if our heart is made up, and we understand God is in control, and he has a plan for our lives, then we can work along with him. Teachers always tell us, we might not ever understand everything, we not can explain everything, but we are to rest in God, not in our own understanding. So we trust God. And sometimes, even you can see in the story, sometimes things look overwhelming. But what we must understand, God is already at work. God already has finished the plan. All we have to do is do what God says do. It doesn't look good. It looks kind of strange. It looks overwhelming. You know, God, it looks doubtful. But God said, guess what? You're not doing this on your own. You're not doing this by yourself. I am with you. And I've given you everything you need to carry out what I've given you to do. Teacher said it again. We must be like James. Just don't be a hearer of the word. We must be a doer of the word. And as you go through this lesson, as we talk to some of us today, there might be a burden on someone to do something. And what it is, you don't want to leave that comfort zone. You don't want to get, well, God got you so comfortable. I'm elevated now. I'm in a place where I want to be in security, and I don't want to move. Well, God got you there, and God can move you from there, and God can even take you higher. But you have to rest in him, knowing and rest with the assurance that God is in control, God is in charge. I'm just the vessel being used of God. And whatever the purpose is, God will strengthen me to carry out what needs to be done. So as you listen to the lesson, and as you listen about Nehemiah, put yourself in that place, because guess what? Even though things look overwhelming, God has already worked them out.
Amen, amen. This story is a reflection of many of the ones that we've already mm-hmm. looked at. And again, a pastor said it, that this is what we see of God. There is a burden placed on Nehemiah. There's a burden placed on us. Mm-hmm. But this is really where we have to find ourselves. When God has called us to do something, and we see it over and over in the Word of God. So just like the handwriting is on the wall for those who don't do what God says, the handwriting is also on the wall for those of us who are obedient mm-hmm. to the Word of God. If we go back to our first lesson, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. when we look at the Hebrew boys, okay, I want you to understand, to my knowledge, when I study, I don't see anything that Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, or Abednego had done wrong.
Right.
But guess what? Mm-hmm. They were also taken into captivity. So sometimes we are placed in positions and it doesn't have anything to do with what we have mm-hmm. done, in the sense that there might be circumstances brought about that are challenging to us. But as God orchestrated the lives of those men, but key to it is your heart's got to be fixed.
Right.
It's got to be made up. That you understand that, and again, this is a constant message of pastor. And I'll tell you what, if there's anybody that comes to this household of worship and don't get it yet, I don't know if you ever will. He tells us all the time, and it's got to rest with you. Nothing can happen
That's right.
unless God allows it. So then remember, we are in a place that we ought to be able to rest, because why? This is for God's purpose. This is for God's purpose. We belong to Him. And if we belong to Him and it's for God's purpose, God is going to work it out. We see in this first lesson that we had how God had set these young men up for success. They might not have seen it all.
Right.
But they were set up for success. Pastor said, we may not see God working. And I mean, he said, and we certainly understand this. He said that God's already working behind the scenes. It's already worked
right,
out, right?
There you go.
Yeah, we got that. But for mm-hmm. us, we have to wait. So mm-hmm. God is working behind the scene for us, but it's not like it's not already done.
Right.
We just got to get to it's where finished. God yes. right, has said it's going to be. So this is the same story today with Nehemiah.
You know, again, he said it again. It doesn't always mean you've done something wrong to be in the condition of mm-hmm. predicament that you're in. Again, we don't see where Nehemiah did anything wrong. But then later in the lesson, Nehemiah, when he came before the Lord, he confessed
right.
that I've sinned, my family sinned, my nation sinned, God, and we are in this place where we are. Again, we have to be prepared for us to spread God's word wherever it needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
And God said before he comes, or Jesus said before you come back, this word, this gospel must be preached to every nation. So there are places God have to orchestrate us to be in mm-hmm. to spread the word of God. And then again, even when we're in an uncomfortable place, even when we're in a place where we think we shouldn't be, then we still ought to trust and put our hearts and minds and all our strength in God, that he is going to work it out for me. Teacher said it again, what I always said, you know, it can only happen except God allow it. And if God allow it, it's for purpose and it's for his plan, that he may be glorified. So here you go, Nehemiah now is in, he's been taken away also as one of the slaves. But what Nehemiah did, instead of allowing his condition to get the best of him, he works at where he's at. I still believe he trusts God, and because he trusts God, God elevates him mm-hmm. even in a foreign country, in a foreign situation. And God can elevate us when we're in difficult situations if we continue to do what he instructs us to do and not let the situation get the best of us. So, you know, this was a time when Nehemiah now was elevated up, got some status, got some clout, if you allow us to say. He's now in the palace with the king. He's the cupbearer. He's, you know, eating the king's food, all the events. He's going to that also. And it came to a place or a time when some of his friends came back from Jerusalem, and he was asking, how are things there? And they told him, you know, it's bad. You know, the walls, the gates have been burned down, the city's in shambles, and it is just bad. And from hearing this, Nehemiah goes into this depression. He's burdened down because he's concerned about his people. He's concerned about his beloved city and all the things that are going on. And, you know, and he carries this around with him. You know, sometimes when we are burdened with something, sometimes we act too quick. We jump up and move that we need to do something. But Nehemiah didn't. He didn't go to his friends or no one to try to get information what we should do. He went straight to God. And he prayed, and what he did, and before he asked God anything, he let God know, Lord, I'm a sinner. Lord, I deserve where I'm at. We have not been doing what we're supposed to do, Lord. So whatever you allow to fall us, you're still doing, you still adjust God, even by allowing this to befall us. And Lord, you know, this burden is on me, Lord. What can I do, Lord, you know, to be a blessing to you and to your people? You know, and so, you know, the answer really didn't come right then. I mean, he just didn't up and started moving. He waited on God until the time presented itself. You have to understand the purpose of God. Look how God orchestrated Nehemiah through everything he went through the timing that was right, to get him where he needs to be, to do what needs to be done. There was a lesson said, in the fullness of time, Jesus came. So events have to take place for the fullness of time to present itself before us. So all we need to do is work in what God has orchestrated or ordained for us to work in, and we will see God's work fulfilled before us. And sometimes you might not see God at work. You might not feel God, but remember what God says in his word, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you, I'll always be there with you. So when you can't feel God, you can't feel him moving, like you don't even hear from God, still do what God tells you to do, and you'll see God work it out in your life.
Amen, amen. There are two places we find ourselves, either too comfortable or too uncomfortable.
Yes.
And what we have to do is, when we recognize where we are, then we still have to seek God for what it is he would have us do. Now listen, remember our last week's lesson was of King Cyrus, where God had moved upon his heart to rebuild the house of God in Jerusalem. And he requested of those who would like to go back. Well, now he is now, Ezra is there, and those that return with him, that remnant that returned to him. But guess what? They started the work of God, and because of the opposition that came against them, I mean, and again, it was again another proclamation of the king that said, because there were those that came against them and said, what are y'all doing? You know, who gave y'all the right to do this? Well, see, when God has called you to do something, you don't have to have the stamped approval of everybody else.
Right.
You have to trust God. So what we find is that the work started but stopped. And so then there's a brother that comes back, and as Pastor said, when the inquiry was made, the message that came wasn't encouraging. You know, that God's work has started, but and a lot of times we become discouraged because things, I don't know. There has to be a trust in God. And I mean, again, you have to trust him. Understand? To know that God will do what he said. So then it comes back and he's not encouraged. Well, let me tell you this. See, this is a problem. Nehemiah is in a comfortable place. I mean, why would he worry himself about what's going on in Jerusalem? The fact of the matter is, listen, I eat from the king's table. I drink wine from the king's. Listen, you have to understand, what the devil says is, what he would like you to believe is the leftovers of the world are better than what God has called us to do. But again, Nehemiah is not comfortable in this. And the news that he got, that he received, it just kind of took everything out of him. Again, why shouldn't he just go on doing what he's doing? I mean, you know, my family's well.
That's right.
But see, this walk is about more than just us. That's why it says, if the word of God is good for us, then we ought to what? Share that word. We can't just become, you know what? I know who Jesus is. You know, I am filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. If they don't want it, that's not our attitude. You know, I mean, the word of God even tells us that it has to get to the point that we ought to be willing to snatch them out of hell. You know what I'm saying? I mean, now we do it. We're not going to be aggressive. We're going to do it out of love. You know, we're going to live before them. We're going to declare what the word of God says, and we're going to do just that. That's what Nehemiah is doing. But his countenance fell. And listen, what we get out of this is Nehemiah is in the presence of the king all the time. He's in captivity. You know, he is a servant of the king. But the word of God says the king looked at him and said, what's wrong with you?
Right.
I've never seen you. See, listen, that's why I said, when you fast, don't make yourself look like you're going through.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Pick yourself up. You know, and Nehemiah had always, even in his circumstances, he had always in the presence of the king with a joy, you know, in his heart. You know, he had a spirit of encouragement. And so the king could see how he was living. But this particular day, his countenance fell. King said, what's wrong with
That's
you?
Right.
Something's wrong.
Yeah.
And but then Nehemiah didn't intend for it to be that way. He said he got so afraid.
Yes, he was.
You know what I'm saying? Because then the king said, what's wrong with you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, because you don't have no business being that way. And that's what the Lord says to, when he says what? Cast all your cares upon him. Why?
Because he cares.
He cares.
And like you said, again, the burden was so great that Nehemiah let it appear upon his face. And that's what happened. The teacher was saying, sometimes things burden us down, and what we do, we want everybody to know what we're going through. You know, like, I can't make it. We want people to feel sorry for us. Well, you know, but what happened is when we cast our, that's a place where we have to learn to get, you know, to put our, and I know somebody might say, that might be easy for you to say and this, that, and, but you know what? The reason why it's easy for me to say, because I've been there. And by sharing God's word, my thing is to help you not go through what I went through to get there. So if I can help ease some of the pain of your going through by what I went through, for the Bible says the wise man learned from the fool learned from his own. So if I can teach you how to bypass some of the misery I went through to get where God got me to be, that's what I want to do. So I don't have to walk around with it on my face all the time, because God knows exactly what's going on. And God, remember, he's orchestrated everything to get us where we need to be. But you know, Nehemiah now is before the king, and he's so afraid. And the king asked him, what's wrong? And he said, oh, king, live forever. You know, I got this news about my homeland, of my father's sepulcher, where they're buried at, how the gates are burnt down, the city's in ramble. And I'm just so concerned about what's going on over there. And it just burdened me down. And the king said, well, what can I do? What can I do to help you? What can I do to ease this burden that is upon you? And he said, well, oh, king, if you could give me permission that I could go back and check on my fellow countrymen and check on the city and different things of that sort, you know, it would be good. And the first thing they want to know, because Nehemiah is a faithful servant, how long, even the queen was there, how long will you be gone? He said, I just want to be gone long enough to, you know, get things surveyed, get things started, and I will be back. So they want to know when he was coming back. You know, you're a good man. We really want you to be gone long. And he said to the king said, okay, we will do that. But you know what the king did? The king gave him funds to go back with. He even gave him an armed escort to escort him back to Jerusalem. And even Nehemiah asked for permission from the king's keeper of the forest that he could get timber to even build the gates and things back. Watch God. Sometimes we burden ourselves down and we're so worried, and God already got things worked out. The Bible says we have not because we ask not. And when we do ask, we ask disbelieving anyway that God is not going to do it. So why ask God to do something for you if you're going to disbelieve what you're going to, you know, it's going to happen for you? But one of the things is, even though God gives us instruction, even though God is with us, and even though we are walking by faith, look for oppositions. Look for something, situation to try to block us, to try to stop us. Why? Because we're working for God. We're working in a hostile country. This is the devil's kingdom that we're in. He does not want God to progress or have anything of God in this world, so he's going to try his best to stop us. One of the things I learned, when the devil is fighting me that hard, I must be doing something real good if he's trying to stop me that hard. And guess what? It should give me encouragement to keep on going forth, because guess what? I'm accomplishing what God has sent me to do.
Key. When God places a burden in you, pray.
Mm-hmm.
Pray. Seek God's face about what and how it is he would have you proceed. Now, if you're going to worry, you don't need to pray.
Sure.
If you're going to pray, you don't need to worry. All right? You have to trust the Lord. Nehemiah is certainly given the permission that he requests of the king. And it is important for us that we trust the Lord. Listen, it says in Psalms 34 and 15, mm-hmm. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. So when we cry out to the Lord, you remember when Israel was in Egypt, and it said they began to cry out to the Lord, and the Lord heard their cry. So then if that is a true word of God, we have to rest that when we cry out to the Lord, he will hear us. Now, again, we have to be willing to wait on him and move as God gives us the permission to move. And what God is doing at the same time is he is already orchestrating by what means and how to get it done. Mm-hmm. I've said in lessons a few weeks ago, just a tad bit of my testimony when I say that God will touch those who don't even want to do for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
I mean, listen, he showed it to us when he did it to the Hebrew boys with Nebuchadnezzar. I mean, how in the world do slaves, you know, progress to the point where they are first, second, and third mm-hmm. under the king? They're slaves. All the people of Nebuchadnezzar, how in the world do they get in these positions? And the same thing here. I'm sure that some of King Darius' people are certainly more suited to be wine cupbearers. Mm-hmm. But God has Nehemiah here, that he can do what God would have him do. See, listen, people will bless you and then walk away and ask, why in the world did I do that? It doesn't have anything to do with them. It is God moving on their hearts. And they're falling in line because, remember, God is in control of all things. So, yes, the king, I mean, really didn't have a choice of giving Nehemiah the permission he asked for. But mm-hmm. Nehemiah prayed to God. God then touches the heart of the king, and the king gives the letters that he might be able to go through the wilderness and not be challenged and get there. But now, this was key to me this week. You know, there are those of us who are filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost when God calls us to do something. And, you know, we want everybody to know how saved we are. So the first thing we do is we start telling everybody what God told us to do. After the king gave Nehemiah the permission, Nehemiah gets in Jerusalem. He gets there, you know, he doesn't go with all the flamboyancy, so everybody knows that I've got the ear of the king. He said he had the one mule that he was riding on.
Mm-hmm.
He got into the city. He went into the city, and you know what? He didn't even tell those who were there what his purpose was. He didn't share this information because, you know, a lot of times the best thing for us to do is do a survey of where we are, what's going on, and how do we do this? We have to settle down and look around us to see what's going on, to really see how to approach what God is telling us to do. We're praying, we're trusting God, but then, you know, it says that, you know, we can't just have a burden. We got to act on it. But then we have to also trust that God will show us how to act. You know, now, see, and let me say this, because when we say you got a burden, act on it. Please don't get before the burden.
Right.
You remember what God told Israel? When I move,
you move.
You move. When I stop, you stop. Mm-hmm. So then we got to understand this. Don't get before the burden. Continue to wait on. Yes, we got to act. But act in accordance to what God has given us to do. Do it when God has said, because then you know he has stamped his approval on it. And guess what? Let me give you just a little piece of where you can rest. When God tells me to do something and I do it, it's, and don't take this the wrong way, those of you who got issues with it, but it's a pain reliever. You understand? You take the medicine, go on about your business. It ain't on you no more. You do what God says, that's your pain reliever. It's on God. I mean, you may not have that kind of authority in you by the Holy Ghost, but I'm reminded I can't do nothing of myself.
That's right.
So when God gives me something to do and I do it, and it doesn't look like it's going to work, I simply remind God, I thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I thank you for giving me the strength to do what you told me to do. And I bless your name. I go about my business because it's on the Lord then.
I like that. you know what that made me think of? You take the medicine, but it don't act right then.
Right
it
then,
got to get
right.
in your system.
That's
and work
right.
Oh, boy, like that. You know, and what I like about that is, again, before Nehemiah, again, as teacher said, Nehemiah prayed over the burden. And what I like is that's when you have to know what's in God's word.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know what's written. One of our lessons, you have to know what's written.
That's right.
So when Nehemiah went before God, Nehemiah, something you always tell us, you remind God of what God said to you.
Yeah.
And I think Solomon and Moses, I think, did the same thing. When they said, Lord, when we have sinned and you have allowed the enemy to come and take us into foreign lands, if we pray, if we look towards heaven, Lord, you will bless us to return back to our homeland. So in other words, Nehemiah got a promise from God even before he moved. In other words, he's operating off of what God has already promised him he would do. If you do this, this is what I would do. So he's reminding God, he said, if I can't get to the Holy Temple, if I just turn to the direction and look, God, this is what you're going to do. Lord, if I pray and humble myself, this is what you are going to do for us. So Nehemiah is going now with encouragement from God's word, from God's promise of what he's going to do. He's not acting on his own or by himself. He's acting on what God has spoken to him in his word. And this is what Nehemiah is moving towards. And even when God has given you a word, even when God has encouraged your heart to do what is before you, again, opposition is going to come. Teacher said again, you can't tell everybody. And it's sad to say sometimes even in the church, you can't tell everybody about what God has told you. Guess what? It is for you to wrestle. Because sometimes when you start revealing what God has told you to do, you got some people. Well, you know, you got some negative people. And some of them may mean well and some of them don't mean well. But guess what? If you're not careful, they'll talk you out of what God has instructed you to do because you're starting to listen to them. But what you must do is listen to God. And the teacher said it again. Survey the thing, keep it all to yourself, let God work it out in you, and God move, you move. If he stands still, you stand still. Don't get ahead of him, because guess what? When you do, then that's when people can start cutting you down, discouraging you, and you're ready to quit even before you get started. Because guess what? There were two fellows when Nehemiah were coming, you know, watch now. There are people will even try to use that. He got permission from the king to do what he's doing, but because Sanballat them didn't really know what was going on, and Tobiah, they try to go against him and say, look, you know, we're going to tell the king you operating against his will. We're going to tell the king you doing things outside of his order. You're going to tell the king. But what they didn't know Nehemiah already had permission from the king to do what he needs to do. So what you need to do is stay in and under the control of God. Don't let what people say pull you out of where God has you. I tell people on the job sometime, you know, there's a place that God has us already. You know, there's a standard in God where we are. And sometimes the devil uses people to pull us down, to come down from where we are. And sometimes when we get in arguments and debates with people and arguing, Karen, guess what? They'll move us from where God has us to step down on their level to react or to act along with them. No, stay where you are. Mm. Pull them where you are. Don't go down to where they are. If they don't want to come where you are, you stay where you are, but don't let them pull them down to where they are. You stay where you are.
It is really interesting that the way that this story unfolds. When Nehemiah surveys the situation, you know, that's when he comes together with those leaders of the time. Again, what Pastor said is key. We have to recognize those that are with us, those that are praying for the success of what we're called to do. And again, it's not always the people that we think. Mm-hmm. We were studying in our last course, and you know, there was this one who was called Naaman. He was a good man. The word of God says it as though he trusted God, but he was a leprous. And so he came to the man of God to be healed. And, you know, the man of God gave him the word. But, you know, see, it doesn't always sound okay, you know, how many of us can throw a stick in the water and make iron float? See, we've got to recognize that this is God's work. I am just an instrument that God is using to do his work. You know, and well, Pastor, you can't remove yourself from where God placed you if you want to be successful in him. So this man comes and asks, Elisha, I think it is, tells him what to do. And he questions God.
Yeah.
That's what we do when we don't move to what God tells us to do or how it is God tells us to do it. But listen, again, Pastor reminds us that God's work's already done. So there is this little maiden that was brought into captivity. She is in the master's house. And he goes to complaining about what he thought the prophet would do. And if he, you know, because he don't know who I am. See, we have to know who God is. Right. Well, he could have just come out. He didn't even come out. He sent his servant out. And I thought he would wave his hand. And but the maiden in his house said, but master, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? See, it's not in what we measure and how God says it. It's in our obedience. I said, I think in my Wednesday's lesson last Wednesday, that the only thing God ever wanted from us was our obedience. Mm-hmm. That's all. And that's all he is calling us to do. To this day, be obedient to his word. So this thing is unfolding because Nehemiah is being obedient to the word of God. And it doesn't matter who tries to stop you.
That's right.
Because the enemy, this is what the enemy did. Said, listen, we see what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And we know who y'all are. And as soon as y'all get these walls erected, y'all going to go against what the king wants. And we will remind the king that you guys were a rebellious people before, and as soon as you get the wall, you're gonna stop paying tribute. And I mean, all of these things they made up. So they sent letters to the king and said, listen, you need to look into the history. See who these people are. People don't like people of God.
Right.
You got to recognize that. And they will try to stop the success of the work of God. And if you allow them to use you to do that, then you have missed God. So they searched the history, the records. And this is that proclamation that was made by Cyrus. And they found that, yes, this is true. And so Darius writes, let's stop the work. You can't stop God's work.
No.
But in the realm of his authority, they stopped the work. And the work stopped in the walls. But later on, Zerubbabel comes along, and he still moved to get this thing done. And so then the work picks up again. See, because God will complete what he started.
Yes.
I think the word of God says, you know, he doesn't start anything that he's not able to complete. And if he starts it in us, he'll complete it in us. So we just have to rest and let God do what God does best.
Listen, when we keep our hearts and minds set on serving God in all things, he will grant us favor even in the eyes of our enemies. Mm-hmm. And then we must keep on moving. But one of the things, as teacher said just now, about when Nehemiah stopped because of obedience to the king and what was going on, but Zerubbabel came and carried on the work, it reminds me of something. We only play a certain part.
Mm-hmm.
We're not going to do it all.
Right.
Because sometimes I think if we do it all, we might get a big head saying, I did all this, I did this. But God said this even, Jesus said this even to the disciples. One plant, one water, but God gets the increase. So in other words, it is us. We play our part. We do what God tells us to do, and God will be successful in what God has called us to do. And one of the things I looked at again is sometimes even in our preaching, we as preachers, and sometimes the person that we follow behind, sometimes we want to wonder, I did a better work than they did. No. I did greater, more things. No. They did what God ordained them to do at the time they were there. And when you do what God ordained you to do at the time you were there. Mm-hmm. We're not competing. We're not competing ourselves or trying to find out who's the best, who did more. We're all doing the work for God. And guess what? We're all doing this thing together. So we can't pat ourselves on the back saying, this is what I've done. So the glory belongs to God. So all we have to do is submit ourselves, humble ourselves, do what God tells us to do. You know, it's about leaving our comfort zone. Mm-hmm. You know, if we're going to follow God, we have to leave sometimes the things that we love, the things, you know, I'll say this, and I don't know if it's, I guess it would be a comfort zone. It would be a thing about the burden of God and what God would have you do. I remember when I first came into the church, I was that person that loved to go to the gym and work out and work out. After I got saved, I still was doing this. But the thing, was that I was putting that before God. I was putting my workouts, my going to the gym before God. I was, you know, putting God on the back burner. One day, Bishop Frazier said to me, you would be a good youth president but you got other things, other priorities first. You got other things on your mind. See, I was comfortable in doing what I was doing. You know, I felt good, and I was reaching the place I wanted to get. But then he told me I wasn't fulfilling God's purpose in my life. I wasn't doing what God called me to do. Teacher said, God has given us gifts. And sometimes when you're afraid of what God has given you, you want to do anything else but. No, but in order to be successful, you have to do what God called you to do. That's for you to do. And he finally told me, so I had to make up my mind, which was more important, God or what I was doing? Well, this other stuff is only temporary. But what I do for God is forever. Mm-hmm. So guess what? You have to forget it. See, we often say this thing is not about me, but it's all about God. But it was about me. It was what I wanted to do, what I wanted to achieve. It wasn't what God wanted me to do or what God wanted me to achieve. It was what I wanted to do. So we have to make up our minds and humble ourselves and submit ourselves and let that burden, you know, that's when you start sitting down and weighing things out. You know, what's more important? Oh, I mean, what's my benefits? This thing, you know, this isn't going to last, but this thing for God is forever. So you have to forget about yourself. Are you willing to move from where you are now, even though you're comfortable, even though you scratch and scrape to get where you are and you feel like you have arrived? And God say, do this. And sometimes when we're settled, God say, I want you to move over here and do this. I want you to start this. I want you to do that. Lord, but I've done this. Who got us there in the first place? So if God got us there in the first place and we have to move and step to do something else, guess what? That same God that got us there in the first place will get us in the next level, in the next state of our life. We got to trust him. Remember, God is in control. Is your heart and your mind fixed? Is it all about God? Is it about yourself? It can't be about us. It can't be about what we achieve. It can't be about what we have accomplished, because everything we achieve, everything we accomplish is only through, by, and for God. So, and without God, we can't do anything. So, you know, guess what? The burden is being placed on us to move from where we are to where God would have us to be. In the world that we're living in now, in the crisis that we're going through, there's a burden, and God wants us to move upon it. But in order for us to be successful in God, it just can't be a burden that rests on us. We have to move from where we are and start moving to what God has called and moved us to do. And guess what? God is there with us. We're not by ourselves. He won't leave us nor forsake us, and he'll give us everything we need to be successful. So don't feel like you're alone. God is always there with you. Don't be upset by opposition, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So, in other words, remember, if God be for us, who can be against us? Weapons may be formed against us. Guess what? They won't prosper. So guess what? It doesn't mean the weapon won't come up against us.
That's right.
It's just not going to prosper.
just a reminder of God's word in Romans 12:4. It says, mm-hmm. For as we have many members mm-hmm. in one body, and all members yep. have not yep. the same office. This is key to the success of the work of God. In this lesson where Nehemiah goes, what we do is things don't work when people doesn't have one mind. Mm. You know what? And you can have the majority with one mind to do the right thing, and you have one bad apple mm-hmm. in the basket. Well, Pastor just said it. It says a little leaven. Mm-hmm. What?
Leaven the whole.
It will make the whole operation bad. There are a few things in this lesson that we need to extract as members of the body of Christ. When they came together, and Nehemiah called them all together. If you go to the third chapter, I think it is, of Nehemiah, you begin to see the work. Mm. Of the walls being erected and the gates being built. Now, remember, the king had already strengthened their hand. He told them whatever they needed, mm-hmm. provided for them. So this is how it is. You're in the church today, and somebody is giving a word, and God forbid, Pastor don't give it to me, mm-hmm. that God gives it to me. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I should be able to go to Pastor and say, Pastor, the Lord has laid this burden on my heart. Well, you know, some pastors are erected, and the first thing they say, well, God didn't tell me to do it. Okay, then, you know, already you got a problem. The pastors ought to be prayed up too, right, that God is also speaking to them. All right, but so this is how it is. We're getting ready to erect the walls so that the city will be protected. Mm-hmm. But the problem is, you know, it said, and beside him worked him, and beside him worked mm-hmm, him. Mm-hmm. He worked on the wall. He worked in the corner. He worked on the gate. Well, Pastor told me, I ain't working on no gate. This right. is what I want right. to do. No, see, when we're not one, you know what I'm saying? And listen, sometimes you have to do things that if it's not against the will of God, if it's not against the will of God, do it, and you'll be blessed out of your obedience to the word of God. See, if somebody comes to you and asks you to do something that you know is wrong, mm-hmm. you shouldn't do it. And if somebody comes to you and asks you to do something, even though that's not what you want to do, but it will be a help, do it in the name of the Lord. We had a lesson 20 years ago. You know, sometimes you just have to play a role. You have to play a role until God has put you in that place, mm-hmm. right?
That's right.
Where the gift that That's God right. has placed in you is ready to be developed. Sometimes that role is what gets you mm-hmm. to that gift. If you're not willing to play the role, God is never going to give you any more responsibility or authority. But when it started coming together, I mean, and listen, see, even in the midst of this, Nehemiah said, you know, it got so bad that we didn't even take our clothes off no more except to wash them. Mm. You know what? He said, we slept in our clothes and we worked with every opportunity we had to work. Some of them, I said, you don't work no more. You protect us.
Mm-hmm.
You got to have somebody praying for the that's work right. of God. I said, and that's their work. Everybody might not, well, I'm not doing anything. He's not having them. Listen, please, we have to mature and understand the work of the Lord. You're not. See, when you understand how God loves us all, don't misunderstand me. But when you understand your value to God is mm-hmm. only by your obedience, if you're not being obedient to God, you can check the Bible. When people didn't do what God said, there was somebody else that came along, and God used them to do what he wanted to do. Listen, you're not that big of a person. I mean, Nehemiah was humble through this whole mm-hmm. thing to get it done. That's how we have to be.
You know, again, don't worry about being on the forefront. Work behind the scenes.
Hmm.
Because the Bible says, guess what? Those parts that you don't see
right,
sometimes,
right.
those are the most important ones that help the outside of this body function. So don't worry about being the leader all the time. You know what? This is what I say. If God hadn't called me, I didn't want to be no pastor. I didn't want to be it. No, God called me. If it had not been for him calling me, I was fine working with somebody else, helping them do what they have to do because the responsibility is greater. Not that God can't bless me in what I'm doing, but I like working wherever God placed me to work. I don't like all the attention. I don't like all the hoopla, just let me work. But the thing about it is, as teacher was saying, every position in the church is important. That's why Paul uses the body. And you see right now, what part of your body you think is not important to you, get rid of it. But I think everyone that you have function to help this body be successful, and that's what the kingdom of God is. Everyone must play their part, regardless of how small it is, that this kingdom must be successful. And that's what Nehemiah said. Everyone did their job. Guess what? They worked with their swords. Watch while right. you work. As right. you work, watch and pray. So that's mm-hmm. what we have to do. Just don't be also focused on everything else. You forget to pray. Your weapon, it might not be that physical weapon or the sword, but the word of the sword of the spirit, work with it, that God will bless us, that we be successful in whatever God has called us to do. I believe that's our time is about up.
Mm-hmm.
You see, as we bow our heads in a word of prayer.
What's your name?
Father, in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you again, God, for the word that you have given us. I thank you, O God, for the maturity that is being brought to us, O God, that we are learning to grow within you, Lord.
Yes, you know.
I thank you, O God, that we are learning that opposition doesn't mean that you're not with us. Opposition means, God, that you are with us, but the opposition is trying to stop us, O God. But when opposition comes, it allows us to see your strength and your power,
yes,
you know. O God, fulfilled in our lives. Bless us now, Lord Jesus, that we put our confidence in you, that no matter what our situation nor our circumstances, no matter what we're going through, God, you are greater than it. Now, Lord, bless us that we make you bigger than any situation. Lord God, bless us that we recognize you got us where we are.
Yes.
And if we are comfortable now, God, if you want us to move, bless us, God, that we are able and willing to move, God, wherever you have us to go, Lord, to do a work for you. Bless God that we don't think about it being for ourselves, oh God, but God bless us that we think about others
yes.
and we think about you, God, and the work that you call us to do. Now, Father, bless us as teachers that we help make clear to an understanding to your people our roles, oh God, the things that you would have us to do, what may come up against us, God, that we be able to withstand them, God, that we be victorious in you, for you already declared us more than conquerors already, Lord.
Yeah.
So bless God that no matter where we are, God, we put our faith, our confidence, our hearts, and our minds on you, that you will bless us to be successful in whatever venture of life you got us going through now. God, do it for your glory. Do
yes,
it for your honor.
Yes.
For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Bless your name.
As I close out now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceedingly joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. For it's in Jesus' name, let God's people say together, amen.
Amen. Again, we are so grateful. I do want to make this comment before we conclude. I saw something today in our presenting this lesson that is a blessing and an encouragement. Our brother, if I'm wrong in what I say, please forgive me. I think it is Minister Melvin Bailey, if it's Elder,
it's Elder, yeah.
Elder Bailey, excuse me, sir. Certainly, we know that we want to do things correctly. But what I saw today is that Elder Bailey joined in with Pastor Rogers and myself in teaching.
All right.
In teaching this class. You know, when brothers come together in love, and our purpose is the same, and that is to declare God's word. Mm. You know, that was my last point. When Israel came together as one, the work began, and then there was nothing that was able to stop it. And that's how we have to be. There is really, truly, no I in team.
Oh.
That's not how you spell it. You know, but when we come together as one in God to do the will of God, we say, listen, God said it about evil people. And when the people are one, there is nothing that they set their mind to do that they will be unable to do. See, people don't know the power of one. They just don't understand it. Because this is what the Word of God said. For if they had known, if we really knew the power of one, we wouldn't be fighting each other. We would come together in oneness, and God would show himself strong.
Amen.
And that's what we have to do. I just wanted to say to my brother today, we appreciate you.
Amen.
I mean, you're not the only one that signed on, but I saw it.
Mm.
I saw the comments constantly ringing, encouraging us. Move on, brother.
Yes,
amen.
Yeah,
praise the Lord. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So that's encouraging coming from one of our brothers. And then, you know, as always, we have our faithful followers. We just want y'all to continue to pray for us. We know we've gone a little long today, but I had to say that. And listen, as always, we say peace.
Amen.
To God be the glory. Keep us in your prayer.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Bless the Lord.
Yes. Again, as always, any questions, any add to, comments, the Lord place something on your heart to say, any burdens on you, God's trying to get you moved towards. And we hope that if it is, we hope that there was something said to make it easier now for you to transition into moving toward that burden that God has placed upon your heart, that more clarity and more understanding that you're able to feel what God has called you to do. Again, continue to pray for Ella Witherspoon and ourselves, that we continue to let God use us, that we bring forth this to the people of God, you know, and continue to carry out God's will.
Amen.
God bless
Amen.
You. That's all. We can prepare ourselves for our services.